Today, we're going to go take a tour of EastSide Sound, the longest-running recording studio in downtown New York City, and talk to Grammy-winning engineer Marc Urselli. His credits include legendary artists like U2, Foo Fighters, Nick Cave, Lou Reed, and I could go on and on.
When I'm doing drums out here, I usually place them here with the drummer facing that way. These are high-end preamps from Japan. I am an avid experimentator, and I like trying new things.
So let's go check it out. All right, we're here at EastSide Sound in New York City and gonna do a tour today with Marc Urselli. Hey, Marc.
Hello.
Thanks so much for having us and showing us around the space today.
Happy to have you. Thanks for coming.
Awesome. So why don't we go to the main control room first? Start there.
Let's do it. All right. Down this way. Follow me. And then this is our control room. This is now the oldest recording studio in New York.
No kidding.
Opened in 1968 by Lou Holtzman. And Andres Pollack is our new owner. And he just bought the studio a little over a year ago. So we've been bringing in a lot of new equipment because Andres owned the studio in Chile before. So for example, if you look behind you here, there's a big rack of analog gear. Some of it was already here before Andres. Some of it Andres brought. This rack is also new. So, you know, we are now drowning in Neve preamps.
Seriously, you got the Neve desk and some.
Yes, we have 32 Neve preamps on the console, which are kind of 1081-ish models that go into the Genesis. We have 1073s. We have Rupert Neve designs. We have these Neves, we have Vintex, we have
every flavor of Neve.
Every flavor of Neve, and then every flavor of Manly. We have Harrison preamps, you know, we have Focusrite preamps. So much good equipment. It's a pleasure to work in this studio. Also, Synchro Seed. These are high-end preamps from Japan, a company that I work with and really enjoy. Their preamps. Of course, we have some APIs.
So you guys obviously have so much gear in here. Are there any pieces that you are particularly fond of, or, you know, pieces that you always will go to in a recording session?
I mean, my fondness is the console.
Yeah.
I like working in the analog domain on the console. So I try to do as much on the console as possible. In other words, I try to do things there before I reach for a plugin. But anytime I want to do something, especially during mixing sessions, then, you know, I go to things like the Shadow Hills or the Manly Slam things. It's usually compression that I do with outboard gear because, frankly, I mean, like I mentioned before, when you have 32 Neve preamps, you don't really need to reach for other preamps, unless, of course, you want to use a different flavor.
Sure.
For example, I've come, and it's just a matter of being used to it, not that the Neve wouldn't sound great on the piano, but I've always used API 512s on the piano. So I tend, because in that sense, I'm a little bit of a creature of habit, like most people, I tend to stick to what I know.
Is there any, like, particularly unique pieces where, you know, if something went down, you'd be like, I'm sure to grab this thing.
I mean, I love an LA-2A.
So, yeah.
You know, if I had to pick one, I'd probably grab one of those.
Yeah, keep it classic. You can't go wrong with that.
I mean, it's a great compressor on vocals and so many other things, so.
All right, so being from a microphone company, I'm curious to know, how do you choose a microphone for a certain session and kind of what goes through your mind when you're, you know, having an artist into the studio and looking at the mic locker, the vintage stuff, the modern stuff, kind of what are you gravitating towards? What are you thinking about?
It's a very good question. A lot of it is based on experience and knowing what has sounded good previously. And so if you don't have much time to experiment or try new things, then you reach for that. You reach for the known, for what has worked. And obviously, there's many workhorses in that category that we know and love and have worked on a million sessions before. But I am an avid experimentator, and I like trying new things. So nowadays, I often make decisions based on the type of microphone. So if I'm recording, if I want a ribbon microphone, which as we know are softer sounding, less high end, on to maybe soften some a very harsh kind of source, let's say something, you know, if I think harsh sounding, I think like a xylophone, there's a lot of high end. So maybe using a ribbon mic will smooth some of that high end without you having to actually reach for an EQ, which is a lot of what I try to do. Get the right mic choice down so I don't have to do any EQing or much EQing later.
Yeah.
And then the other thing that has a lot of importance in the choice is the polar pattern. Because if I'm recording something next to other instruments, then you know I might not go for an Omni capsule. I'll go for a different kind of capsule. If I have different microphone, different people in the same room, then again the figure eight of a ribbon microphone might be just what you need. So you can use the null point to get rid of leakage. So those are the kind of things that I think about when choosing a microphone.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. A combination of complementing the source and then also thinking strategically about mic placement, that kind of stuff.
Absolutely.
Okay, so what makes a microphone great?
Well, the answer is the same answer that photographers will give about their cameras. The best microphone is the one that you have.
Sure.
That you have with you when you have to record something. Now, if you're in a recording studio like EastSide Sound and you have access to hundreds of microphones to choose from, then the best microphone is the one that translates or records and reproduces the sound you're trying to record in the most accurate way, but also in the most musical way. Because if you're recording things, if you're doing a solo, say a solo piano record, then there's one kind of microphone or microphones I would use on a piano. But if the piano is being recorded in the context of, say, a jazz trio, then I might use a different kind of microphone. So context is very important. Watch your steps. So yeah, you're standing in the live room. And then everywhere you see doors or windows, there's a separate ISO booth.
Oh, wow.
We have six ISO booths that are all looking into the live room. So basically, you can have seven musicians playing together and looking at each other. Most of the booths have direct line of sight with the live. Well, all of the booths have direct line of sight with the live room, but some of them also have direct line of sight with the other booths. So it's a very good space to play music together, to track music together.
Yeah, do you find that you do that a lot, live tracking particularly?
That is, I would say that's definitely our bread and butter. 70 or 80% of our sessions are recording sessions because of the industry and the times we live in. You know, a lot of people, me, myself included, they mix things at home because it's quick, it's comfortable. Most importantly, the budgets are such that you have to cut corners somewhere. So in my opinion, it's better if you are going to have to cut corners in your budget, it's better to mix in the box but record properly than not record really badly and then go to a fancy studio to mix it.
Yeah, get it right at the source, right?
Absolutely. The source is the most important. Shit in, shit out. You know, gold in, gold out.
It's hard to replicate, you know, the experience here, right, where you can be all in the same space but still isolated and have, you know, all of this gear here. I mean, you can do a lot tracking, you know, overdubs at home, but this is definitely a unique thing.
Yeah, and also, I mean, I record a lot of jazz and rock and, shall we call them, organic type of music, for lack of better words. So it's so much more important to have that recorded properly and to have people play together rather than piecemeal it one at a time.
Yeah, and does piano get a lot of use in here as well?
It does. We do tons of jazz, and it's actually a really beautiful instrument. It's a Steinway B, made in New York. It's got Renner action, and a lot of piano players like Fred Hirsch and Matt Mitchell, they all love this piano, so they keep coming back to record on it because it's got such a great and beautiful, comfortable action and beautiful sound.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Awesome. And I see you got some drums set up in this booth here.
This is usually our drum booth. But if we do a rock session and the piano is not used or is less important than having a big drum sound, then we'll set up the drums out here and throw the piano in there.
Yeah, any special placements for room mics when you're doing drums out here and you want that big sound?
When I'm doing drums out here, I usually place them here with the drummer facing that way. And I usually put the room mics as far away as possible. So in these, this is one of the furthest corner from the drummer. So I would put one there and maybe one over by the entrance.
Yeah.
We also have, our original owner, Lou Holtzman, was a drummer in his youth. And so he has a huge collection of amazing vintage Roger drum sets.
Oh, cool.
So we have two here in house. These are all original. Some are rewrapped, but all original wrappings and original hardware, Buddy Rich, typical drums, Ramones, you know. And then the new owner, Andres, has brought us a beautiful DW set. So we have, you know, the again, like with microphones and outboard equipment, the perfect combination of vintage and new.
Yeah, if gotta you
want,
have it all.
Yeah, if you want the new hardware, you go for the DW. If you want the old jazz bebop drum sets, you go for the Rogers. And I can't tell you how many drummers come here and they're like, well, I can't believe you have an original Rogers. They don't believe it. They read it on the website and they think there's some that we have some copy.
Sure.
They don't even realize, you know.
Another question, kind of going back to the idea of choosing microphones and preparing for a session, I guess what advice might you give to aspiring engineers about how do you really prepare for a recording session? What is important to be thinking about there?
The word prepare is the key word there. Preparation, I always talk about this in master classes and workshops, is really the most important thing about how you prepare for the session, meaning get all your facts and your information and be ready for those facts and information to change. You know, working with Hal Wilner, who was a mentor for me for 10 years, was a big lesson in that sense, meaning he didn't always provide me with as much information as I would have liked to. And he was known to add things last minute or change his mind last minute or most likely add another musician. So I would get, you know, I would talk to him and make sure I knew how many musicians are coming, and then I would prepare for more than that. So if you make those kind of adjustments in your workflow, let's say they tell you, you know, there's going to be three guitar players, plan for four or for five.
Yeah.
Because even if only two show up, you're not going to ever look like the guy that doesn't know what he's supposed to do next to make things happen smoothly and quickly. If I have everything ready, then I'm ready to go to that next step, whatever that next step is.
Yeah, absolutely. Extra stuff set up, ready to go, so you don't have to worry about it. And what about for, you know, maybe with some artists, they're so comfortable in a studio environment that, you know, there isn't much you need to do in this, but for other performers, are there techniques or tips that you have for how do you get the best performance out of someone in the studio, and kind of what can you do as an engineer to get the best performance from someone?
A lot depends on whether you're just the engineer or also the producer. Oftentimes I wear both hats. Sometimes I wear only one hat, and the things you do or say change based on that role. So if I'm just the engineer, the only thing I can make sure is that they get everything they need, that their sound is recorded properly. I let them hear it after, you know, we do the first take to make sure they're happy with it. If there's any adjustments to make, or if they want to try different microphones or a different guitar amp, those are things I want to offer as a possibility so that they feel like I'm listening, I'm paying attention, I'm engaged in what they're doing, and I want to make sure their sound comes through the proper way.
Yeah.
And then if you're also the producer, there's a whole other thing, a whole other layer of psychology that comes into place in how to make an artist feel at ease, feel comfortable. Because only when they feel comfortable and at ease, you're going to get the best performance.
Yeah.
If they feel like they're stressed for time or whatever, you're not going to get the best performance. And it's in everyone's best interest to get the best performance.
Yeah, absolutely.
Another thing I'm proud of, come, I'll show you this. It's going to be a little tight. There's another booth.
Oh.
Which is behind 8 inches of foam and has a beautiful amp room that contains more than 10 guitar and bass amps.
Oh, wow.
So follow me in here and I'll show you. Like I said, going to be a little tight because it's not meant for people, but just for...
Oh, dang. Floor to ceiling.
So what's special about this room is that there's all these different guitar amps. So there's a classic twin reverb. Then there's more, more rare things like this Chandler Limited, an RCA guitar amp, a Fender DeVille, a Sun for those guitar players that want the 90s Nirvana type of sound. This is a antique Geloso from Italy, a tube mic. This is a Gensbenz, a German mic for those people that like metal tones. This is a Quilter, another deluxe, Reverb Deluxe. And then we also have, and down here, there's a 2x12 Fender cab. And then there's a 1x15 GK cab, which can go with this Ampeg SVT Pro. On top of that, we also have some guitar and bass amps that are floaters that can, in case we have a guitar player that wants to be next to his amp. The ability of this booth is to basically, it's connected to all the other booths and the control room. So you can have a guitar player sit in the control room. The signal comes via patch bay to this room. And then I have two microphone stands already ready. You can see there's a trusty 57 and there's another shock mount ready for whatever microphone you want to add in front. And then there's this cable that basically comes from the patch bay and you just put it into whichever head you want. And then every head has a female speaker cable. So you can grab, this is the cab, see it's labeled cab. So you can put the cab into whichever head you want. And have the combination of whichever head and cab you want to use. It's always mic'd. There's always two mics ready to go. They're already wired. The other cool thing, if you want to come in here a little closer, is that there's these power strips that are labeled with the names of the amps.
Huh.
So you can just turn on whichever amp you want. You want the RCA, you want the DeVille, you want the Sun, the Geloso. You just turn on this power switch and it's ready to go.
And it's isolated enough that you don't hear anything.
100%.
That's amazing. There's
8 inches of foam plus a wooden door. So when you close this, you basically don't hear anything. You just hear very muffled, distant sound.
Yeah.
There's another booth there. There's another booth there. And then this is usually our vocal booth where I have set up a beautiful Lewitt. And this is usually our vocal booth because, as you can see, the view is such that the vocalist can see everyone from here. And usually it's the vocalist that oftentimes is giving cues as to what needs to happen next. And so this is the booth that has the best outlook on all the other booths.
So you mentioned this is a pretty old studio. Was the diffusion and treatment kind of redone more recently, or is it always sort of looked like this, essentially?
Well, so the studio, the original studio was two blocks away from here on Allen Street.
Oh, okay.
That's the location that was opened more than 50 years ago. This studio was built right after 9/11. So it's about 20 years old. So it's not as old as the original, although a lot of the woodwork has been recovered and reused. For example, this wood, which is now we affectionately call the piano wall, was originally the back of the control room in the original studio.
Yeah.
So this was the diffusing element of the backside of the control room, and we've repurposed it. All of these doors, these heavy doors, which are beautifully made in very, very heavy, massive wood. I forget what wood, maybe walnut, I forget what it is. Were built by Richie Bittner, who was one of the original partners and designers of the original EastSide Sound. And then the control room was designed by Frank Commentali, who is a famous studio designer, architect in New York. He's built a room at Avatar, Wycliffe Jean's room, one of Alicia Keys' room. So he's a guy that's been around building studios for a long time.
Are there any like beloved instruments, beyond the piano, obviously, we talked about that, any like guitars that just sort of live here in house or?
Yeah, we have a bunch of guitars in house. I have my first guitar here, which is a 1983 Fender Strat.
Nice.
Very first instrument I bought. Now I own about 35 guitars. I have a collection that's uncalled for somebody who doesn't play guitar. But, you know, I fell into it. A lot of it happened when I was working with Les Paul, I mentioned to you before, in 2005. It kind of happened like a joke, meaning he was here. And I realized I was in front of the legend, and I wanted to have him sign my guitars, but I didn't have the heart to give him a Fender. So I was like, I need to buy a Gibson so he can sign my Gibson. So I bought my roommate at the time, 2005, had a Epiphone. So I bought that so he would sign it. But I still didn't feel quite right to give Mr. Les Paul an Epiphone.
Yeah, sure.
Right. So I was poor at the time. So I just saved up my money and I bought my first Gibson Les Paul and I went to him and had him sign. And then I kind of just fell into that rabbit hole and I ended up buying another four or five, had him all signed. I now have at least three or four Gibson Les Paul's guitars and basses that I had signed by Mr. Les Paul himself. Those don't live here, they live somewhere else. But then, you know, I have a variety of guitars for whatever, acoustic, electric, for whatever use.
Okay, so I have one more question for you. If you could give one piece of advice to an aspiring audio engineer or producer, what would it be?
Well, short of telling you to go into law or medicine,
something that pays a little better.
Something that pays better. If you're going to become an engineer, there's going to be a very, very long, long, long and hard road ahead of you. So my number one advice is know that that's really what you want to do, and don't be fooled by the ads in the subway that, you know, tell you you can be a producer. You know, just don't buy what is being sold to you as the dream. If it's really your dream to be an engineer, then by all means, go for it. But be prepared for the long hours, for the hard work, for the no money, for all the sacrifices that all of us in this line of work have had to do at some point. So, along with preparation, which we talked about before, the other thing, and preparation in the case of becoming an engineer includes, you know, reading, watching, learning, all of the things, being present at sessions as much as you can will teach you so much more than you can learn from YouTube videos, as much as YouTube videos can be great. But it's, you know, real life experience is the most important thing. That's why when I was 17 or 19, I came here as an intern, because with the gear that I had in my studio in Italy, I felt there was nothing more for me to learn. So I needed new challenges and I needed to see how other people work. So if you can get an internship in a studio, make sure you're in a place where music is being made and recorded and mixed all the time. Make sure you watch and pay close attention. Make sure you're on fly on the wall and you're really transparent so you can absorb without being in the way. And after all of that is happening for you, make sure you talk to people and make sure you mingle with the people that are part of this community, because this is a community. And it's not just the engineers, it's also the musicians and the producers and the backline techs. Everyone is part of the same community. Mm-hmm. Community is an extremely important thing. And if you try to act outside of it, you don't realize the richness that the community has to offer in terms of learning experiences, in terms of contacts. The people that are part of that community are going to be the people that make the fabric of what you're going to be and what you're going to work on and who you're going to work with. So community, I would say, after preparation and experience and learning, is just as important.
I love it. A lot of tips packed into one there, but what I took away at least is, if you're going to be in it and be serious about it and know it's what you want to do.
100%. You have to be 100% committed, or 1000% committed. You can't do engineering halfway, which is also why I don't want to be critical, but I'm not a fan of people trying to do that and many other things, because I've spent my whole life trying to become a better engineer. I'm still trying to become a better engineer. I learn new things every day. And if you're trying to do that on the side while also trying to be a musician and also trying to be a videographer and also trying to be, you know, a video editor and an influencer, something's got to give.
Sure.
So you know, you only have that much time in the day. And if you're allotting, say, a fifth to those five categories, you're only going to be one fifth the engineer that you could be if you apply yourself 100% of the time. So it's a decision you have to make.
Well, cool. Thank you so much for hanging out with us and relaying some wisdom. I've definitely really enjoyed it.
Happy to help. Thanks for having me.
Thank you so much for watching this video. Let us know down in the comments, what was your favorite part of the studio tour? Or was there a certain piece of gear that you were drooling over? And be sure to like the video and subscribe to our channel to stay tuned for more content like this.